Hey guys, it's your buddy Drew with Living History's Mysteries and Three-Eyed Raven Productions. You know, on this channel we try to find the most interesting pieces of history, not the same humdrum boring stuff that you find on every single channel, but more interesting pieces that aren't so easy to find. I was researching something totally different a couple days ago when I ran across a video on armor. And I started thinking, armor began in the Middle Ages as a tool, a defense. In the last couple hundred years, it developed more into a decor or a symbol of rank. Within the last 100 years, it went back to its original implementation as a defense. Body armor for the military, body armor for law enforcement. And I start thinking, why not do a video on the history of armor? So today, that's what we're going to look at right here on Living History's Mysteries. Stay tuned.
Monday, can you start the armor documentary, please?
Yes, boss.
Leave it to a Monday to never go right.
Armor, British English or Canadian English, or armor, American English, see spelling differences, is a protective covering that is used to prevent damage from being inflicted to an object, individual or vehicle by direct contact weapons or projectiles, usually during combat, or from damage caused by a potentially dangerous environment or activity, for example, cycling, construction sites, etc. Personal armor is used to protect soldiers and war animals. Vehicle armor is used on warships and armored fighting vehicles. A second use of the term armor describes armored forces, armored weapons, and their role in combat. After the evolution of armored warfare, mechanized infantry and their weapons came to be referred to collectively as armor. The word armor began to appear in the Middle Ages as a derivative of Old French. It is dated from 1297 as a male, defensive covering worn in combat. The word originates from the Old French, itself derived from the Latin meaning arms and or equipment, with the root meaning arms or gear. Armor has been used throughout recorded history. It has been made from a variety of materials, beginning with rudimentary leather protection and evolving through mail and metal plate into today's modern composites. For much of military history, the manufacture of metal personal armor has dominated the technology and employment of armor. Armor drove the development of many important technologies of the ancient world, including wood lamination, mining, metal refining, vehicle manufacture, leather processing, and later decorative metalworking. Its production was influential in the Industrial Revolution, and furthered commercial development of metallurgy and engineering. Armor was the single most influential factor in the development of firearms, which in turn revolutionized warfare. Significant factors in the development of armor include the economic and technological necessities of its production. For instance, plate armor first appeared in medieval Europe when water-powered trip hammers made the formation of plates faster and cheaper. Also, modern militaries usually do not equip their forces with the best armor available because it would be prohibitively expensive. At times, the development of armor has paralleled the development of increasingly effective weaponry on the battlefield, with armorers seeking to create a better protection without sacrificing mobility. Well-known armor types in European history include the Lorica Hamata, Lorica Squamata, and the Lorica Segmentata of the Roman legions, the male hauberk of the early medieval age, and the full steel plate harness worn by later medieval and Renaissance knights, and breast and back plates worn by heavy cavalry in several European countries until the first year of World War I, 1914-15. The samurai warriors of feudal Japan utilized many types of armor for hundreds of years up to the 19th century. Cuirasses and helmets were manufactured in Japan as early as the 4th century. Tonko, worn by foot soldiers, and keiko, worn by horsemen, were both pre-samurai types of early Japanese armor constructed from iron plates connected together by leather thongs. Japanese lamellar armor, keiko, passed through Korea and reached Japan around the 5th century. These early Japanese lamellar armors took the form of a sleeveless jacket, leggings, and a helmet. Armor did not always cover all of the body. Sometimes no more than a helmet and leg plates were worn. The rest of the body was generally protected by means of a large shield. Examples of armies equipping their troops in this fashion were the Aztecs, 13th to 15th century CE. In East Asia, many types of armor were commonly used at different times by various cultures, including scale armor, lamellar armor, laminar armor, plated mail, mail, plate armor, and brigandine. Around the dynastic Tang, Song, and early Ming period, cuirasses and plates, Mingguangjia, were also used, with more elaborate versions for officers in war. The Chinese, during that time, used partial plates for important body parts instead of covering their whole body, since too much plate armor hinders their martial arts movement. The other body parts were covered in cloth, leather, lamellar, or mountain pattern. In Precheng Dynasty times, leather armor was made out of various animals, with more exotic ones such as the rhinoceros. Mail, sometimes called chainmail, made of interlocking iron rings, is believed to have first appeared sometime after 300 BC. Its invention is credited to the Celts. The Romans are thought to have adopted their design. Gradually, small additional plates or discs of iron were added to the mail to protect vulnerable areas. Hardened leather and splinted construction were used for arm and leg pieces. The coat of plates was developed, an armor made of large plates sewn inside a textile or leather coat. Early plate in Italy, and elsewhere in the 13th-15th century, were made of iron. Iron armor could be carburized or case-hardened to give a surface of harder steel. Plate armor became cheaper than mail by the 15th century, as it required much less labor and labor had become much more expensive after the Black Death, though it did require larger furnaces to produce larger plumes. Mail continued to be used to protect those joints which could not be adequately protected by plate, such as the armpit, crook of the elbow, and groin. Another advantage of plate was that a lance rest could be fitted to the breastplate. The small skull cap evolved into a bigger true helmet, the bassinet, as it was lengthened downward to protect the back of the neck and the sides of the head. Additionally, several new forms of fully enclosed helmets were introduced in the late 14th century. Probably the most recognized style of armor in the world became the plate armor associated with the knights of the European late Middle Ages, but continuing to the early 17th century Age of Enlightenment in all European countries. By about 1400, the full harness of plate armor had been developed in armories of Lombardy. Heavy cavalry dominated the battlefield for centuries, in part because of their armor. In the early 15th century, advances in weaponry allowed infantry to defeat armored knights on the battlefield. The quality of the metal used in armor deteriorated as armies became bigger and armor was made thicker, necessitating breeding of larger cavalry horses. If during the 14th-15th centuries armor seldom weighed more than 15 kilograms, then by the late 16th century it weighed 25 kilograms. The increasing weight and thickness of late 16th century armor therefore gave substantial resistance. In the early years of low-velocity firearms, full suits of armor, or breastplates actually stopped bullets fired from a modest distance. Crossbow bolts, if still used, would seldom penetrate good plate, nor would any bullet unless fired from close range. In effect, rather than making plate armor obsolete, the use of firearms stimulated the development of plate armor into its later stages. For most of that period, it allowed horsemen to fight while being the targets of defending arquebusiers without being easily killed. Full suits of armor were actually worn by generals and princely commanders right up to the second decade of the 18th century. It was the only way they could be mounted and survey the overall battlefield with safety from distant musket fire. The horse was afforded protection from lances and infantry weapons by steel plate barding. This gave the horse protection and enhanced the visual impression of a mounted knight. Late in the era, elaborate barding was used in parade armor. Gradually, starting in the mid-16th century, one plate element after another was discarded to save weight for foot soldiers. Back and breast plates continued to be used throughout the entire period of the 18th century and through Napoleonic times, in many European, heavy, cavalry units, until the early 20th century. From their introduction, muskets could pierce plate armor, so cavalry had to be far more mindful of the fire. In Japan, armor continued to be used until the end of the samurai era, with the last major fighting in which armor was used happening in 1868. Samurai armor had one last short-lived use in 1877 during the Satsuma Rebellion. Though the age of the knight was over, armor continued to be used in many capacities. Soldiers in the American Civil War bought iron and steel vests from peddlers. Both sides had considered but rejected body armor for standard issue. The effectiveness of the vests varied widely. Some successfully deflected bullets and saved lives, but others were poorly made and resulted in tragedy for the soldiers. In any case, the vests were abandoned by many soldiers due to their weight on long marches, as well as the stigma they got for being cowards from their fellow troops. At the start of World War I, thousands of the French cuirassiers rode out to engage the German cavalry. By that period, the shiny armor plate was covered red in dark paint and a canvas wrap covered their elaborate Napoleonic-style helmets. Their armor was meant to protect only against sabers and light lances. The cavalry had to beware of high-velocity rifles and machine guns, unlike the foot soldiers, who at least had a trench to protect them. Today, ballistic vests, also known as flak jackets, made of ballistic cloth, for example Kevlar, Dyneema, Twerin, Spectra, etc., and ceramic or metal plates are common among police forces, security staff, corrections officers, and some branches of the military. The U.S. Army has adopted interceptor body armor, which uses enhanced small arms protective inserts, ESAPI, in the chest, sides, and back of the armor. Each plate is rated to stop a range of ammunition, including 3 hits from a 7.62x51 NATO AP round at a range of. Dragon skin body armor is another ballistic vest which is currently in testing with mixed results. The first modern production technology for armor plating was used by navies in the construction of the ironclad warship, reaching its pinnacle of development with the battleship. The first tanks were produced during World War I. Aerial armor has been used to protect pilots and aircraft systems since the First World War. In modern ground forces usage, the meaning of armor has expanded to include the role of troops in combat. After the evolution of armored warfare, mechanized infantry were mounted in armored fighting vehicles and replaced light infantry in many situations. In modern armored warfare, armored units equipped with tanks and infantry fighting vehicles serve the historic role of both the battle cavalry, light cavalry, and dragoons, and belong to the armored branch. The first ironclad battleship, with iron armor over a wooden hull, La Gloire, was launched by the French Navy in 1859, prompting the British Royal Navy to build a counter. The following year they launched HMS Warrior, which was twice the size and had iron armor over an iron hull. After the first battle between two ironclads took place in 1862 during the American Civil War, it became clear that the ironclad had replaced the unarmored line of battleship as the most powerful warship afloat. Ironclads were designed for several roles, including as high seas battleships, coastal defense ships, and long-range cruisers. The rapid evolution of warship design in the late 19th century transformed the ironclad from a wooden hull vessel which carried sails to supplement its steam engines into the steel-built, turreted battleships and cruisers familiar in the 20th century. This change was pushed forward by the development of heavier naval guns. The ironclads of the 1880s carried some of the heaviest guns ever mounted at sea, more sophisticated steam engines, and advances in metallurgy which made steel shipbuilding possible. The rapid pace of change in the ironclad period meant that many ships were obsolete as soon as they were complete, and that naval tactics were in a state of flux. Many ironclads were built to make use of the ram or the torpedo, which a number of naval designers considered the crucial weapons of naval combat. There is no clear end to the ironclad period, but towards the end of the 1890s the term ironclad dropped out of use. New ships were increasingly constructed to a standard pattern and designated battleships or armored cruisers. Armored trains saw use during the 19th century in the American Civil War, 1861 to 1865, the Franco-Prussian War, 1870 to 1871, the First and Second Boer Wars 1880-81 and 1899 to 1902, the Polish-Soviet War, 1919 to 1921, the First, 1914 to 1918, and Second World Wars, 1939 to 1945, and the First Indochina War, 1946 to 1954. The most intensive use of armored trains was during the Russian Civil War, 1918 to 1920. Armored cars saw use during World Wars I and II. During the Second Boer War on November 15, 1899, Winston Churchill, then a war correspondent, was traveling on board an armored train when it was ambushed by Boer commandos. Churchill and many of the train's garrison were captured, though many others escaped, including wounded placed on the train's engine. Ancient siege engines were usually protected by wooden armor, often covered with wet hides or thin metal to prevent being easily burned. Medieval war wagons were horse-drawn wagons that were similarly armored. These contained guns or crossbowmen that could fire through gun slits. The first modern AFBs were armored cars, developed circa 1900. These started as ordinary wheeled motor cars protected by iron shields, typically mounting a machine gun. During World War I, the stalemate of trench warfare during on the Western Front spurred the development of the tank. It was envisioned as an armored machine that could advance under fire from enemy rifles and machine guns, and respond with its own heavy guns. It utilized caterpillar tracks to cross ground broken up by shell fire in trenches. With the development of effective anti-aircraft artillery in the period before the Second World War, military pilots, once the knights of the air during the First World War, became far more vulnerable to ground fire. As a response, armor plating was added to aircraft to protect aircrew in vulnerable areas such as fuel tanks and engine. Tank armor has progressed from the Second World War armor forms, now incorporating not only harder composites, but also reactive armor designed to defeat shaped charges. As a result of this, the main battle tank, MBT, conceived in the Cold War era, can survive multiple RPG strikes with minimal effect once crew or the operation of the vehicle. The light tanks that were the last descendants of the light cavalry during the Second World War have almost completely disappeared from the world's militaries due to increased lethality of the weapons available to the vehicle-mounted infantry. The Armored Personnel Carrier, APC, was devised during World War I. It allows the safe and rapid movement of infantry in a combat zone, minimizing casualties and maximizing mobility. APCs are fundamentally different from the previously used armored half-tracks in that they offer a higher level of protection from artillery burst fragments, and greater mobility in more terrain types. The basic APC design was substantially expanded to an infantry fighting vehicle, IFB, when properties of an armored personnel carrier and a light tank were combined in one vehicle. Naval armor has fundamentally changed from the Second World War doctrine of thicker plating to defend against shells, bombs and torpedoes. Passive defense naval armor is limited to Kevlar or steel, either single layer or a spaced armor, protecting particularly vital areas from the effects of nearby impacts. Since ships cannot carry enough armor to completely prevent penetration by anti-ship missiles, they depend more on destroying an incoming missile before it hits, or causing it to miss its target. Although the role of the ground attack aircraft significantly diminished after the Korean War, it reemerged during the Vietnam War, and in the recognition of this, the U.S. Air Force authorized the design and production of what became the A-10 dedicated anti-armor and ground attack aircraft that first saw action in the Gulf War. High-voltage transformer fire barriers are often required to defeat ballistics from small arms as well as projectiles from transformer bushings and lightning arresters, which form part of large electrical transformers, per an FPA 850. Such fire barriers may be designed to inherently function as armor, or may be passive fire protection materials augmented by armor, where care must be taken to ensure that the armor's reaction to fire does not cause issues with regards to the fire barrier being armored to defeat explosions and projectiles in addition to fire, especially since both functions must be provided simultaneously, meaning they must be fire tested together to provide realistic evidence of fitness for purpose. Combat drones use little to no vehicular armor as they are not manned vessels. This results in them being lightweight and small in size. Barding, also spelled bard or barb, is body armor for war horses, especially as used by European knights. During the late Middle Ages, as armor protection for knights became more effective, their mounts became targets. This vulnerability was exploited by the Scots at the Battle of Bannockburn in the 14th century, when horses were killed by the infantry, and for the English at the Battle of Crecy in the same century, where longbowmen shot horses and the then dismounted French knights were killed by heavy infantry. Barding developed as a response to such events. Examples of armor for horses could be found as far back as classical antiquity. Cataphracts, with scale armor for both rider and horse, are believed by many historians to have influenced the later European knights, via contact with the Byzantine Empire. Surviving period examples of barding are rare, however, complete sets are on display at the Philadelphia Museum of Art, the Wallace Collection in London, the Royal Armouries in Leeds, and the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. Horse armor could be made in hull or in part of queer buoy, hardened leather, but surviving examples of this are especially rare.
And there you have it, guys and gals, the history of armor. We know where it came from. We know how it's been used. We know how it's being used now. What's the future hold? What does the future hold?
Future hold, it's only limited by imagination and technology. That's all I got, guys. Until next time, take care of yourselves, take care of each other. God bless you, God love you, I do. We'll see you on the road.